Wilhelm Wundt founded the first exclusive psychology laboratory in 1879. It was a laboratory that conducted experiments related to matters in experimental psychology. Antecedents to psychology. René Descartes lived from 1596 to 1650 and worked to answer the question, are the mind and body the same or different? His answer came to be known as Cartesian dualism, which is the idea that mind and body are different, but that the mind can influence the body and the body can influence the mind. He suggested that whereas the mind is the source of ideas and thoughts, which he correctly located in the brain, the body is a machine-like structure to be studied and understood. René Descartes believed in both nativism and rationalism. A nativist believes that all knowledge is innate and inborn. A rationalist believes that to gain knowledge, one rationalizes or discovers the truth through experience and the operation of the mind. Phrenology was one approach to the mind-body problem studied by Franz Josef Gall, 1758 to 1828, and subsequently popularized by his student, then-colleague Joseph Spurzheim, 1776 to 1832. The basic tenet of phrenology suggested that one could uncover and understand someone's personality by feeling and interpreting the bumps on the head. Phrenology contributed some important ideas to psychology. First, phrenology re-emphasized that the brain is the organ of the mind, and if we are to understand the mind and behavior, the brain is the central area to understand. Second, the idea of localization of function, that different parts of the brain have certain specialties, is an idea that is still with us today. Although phrenology's methods did not last, some of the assumptions of phrenology had great heuristic value. Psychophysics. The area of psychophysics is probably the area of closest transition from philosophers studying behavior to psychologists studying behavior. Three researchers were key in the founding of psychology: Hermann von Helmholtz, 1821-1894, Ernst Weber, 1795-1878, Gustav Fechner, 1801-1887. Hermann von Helmholtz, interested in the general area of psychophysics. Psychophysics is the study of the interaction between the behavioral capabilities and limitations of the human perceptual system and the environment. Ernst Weber, interested in all the sensory systems and how they work. It was Weber who gave psychology the concept of just noticeable difference. That is, the smallest difference between two stimuli that can be noted by a person. This idea of just noticeable difference, or JND, could be applied to all sensory systems: sight, sound, taste, touch, smell. And in experimenting with various sensory systems, Weber found that a constant equation emerged. A JND ratio was found for many of the sensory systems, and this general conceptualization has come to be known as Weber's law. Gustav Fechner. He significantly expanded on the ideas of Weber. In fact, Fechner is said to be the founder of psychophysics, the science of the functional relationship between the mind and the body. Fechner has also been called the father of experimental psychology, and some historians suggest that the founding psychology could be accredited to Fechner in 1850. For the first time in the study of thought, the relationship between the mind and the body could be measured and quantified, leading to the development of Fechner's law, the beginning of psychology. Wundtian psychology and structuralism. Wilhelm Wundt, 1832-1920, is credited with forming the first psychology laboratory exclusively for psychological work in Leipzig, Germany in 1879. Wundt was interested in studying the mind and conscious experience. He believed that a rigorous program of introspection could be used to report the processes at work in the inner consciousness. Introspection was a technique used by researchers to describe and analyze their own inner thoughts and feelings during a research experience. 19th century, Wundt and his laboratory were the center of psychology. And anyone seriously interested in pursuing psychology traveled to Germany to study with Wundt. Perhaps Wundt's greatest influence was the mentoring of students. Over 160 students, an outstanding number, received their PhD under Wundt's supervision. One of those students was Eduard Bradford Titchener, who studied with Wundt in Germany, and then immigrated to Cornell University to promote his own variation of Wundtian psychology called structuralism. Structuralism, the study of the anatomy of the mind, as a system of psychology, shares some common characteristic with Wundt's ideas. Titchener also spells out quite clearly what structuralism was not interested in: applied problems, children, animals, individual differences, and higher mental processes. Titchener's goal for structuralism was to use this rigorous introspective method to discover and identify the structures of consciousness, hence the title Structuralism. Titchener contributed significantly to the rapid growth of psychology in America by having 54 PhD students complete their work under his direction at Cornell University, provided a concrete system of psychology which would later be the subject and focus of major changes in psychology, resulting in an alternative approach to psychology called functionalism. It is important to the history of American psychology because it is a system of psychology that is uniquely American. Wundtian psychology and structuralism both have their roots in Germany, but functionalism is an American product. Functionalists were more interested in how the mind works, what mental processes accomplish, and what role consciousness plays in our behavior. William James, 1842-1910, is noted in this transition period from structuralism to functionalism for his clarity of thought and strong opposition to Titchener. At Harvard University in 1875-1876, he offered a course in the relations between physiology and psychology. James contributed his honorable reputation in standing to oppose the division of consciousness into structures, offering an alternative approach for studying the mind. Stanley Hall, 1844-1924, was a contributor to the founding of functionalism, but probably would not be considered a functionalist. Founding the first American psychology laboratory at Johns Hopkins University in 1883. Founding of the American Psychological Association in 1892. Bringing Sigmund Freud to America in 1909, Freud's only visit to the US. Hall was interested in a number of topics, including studying children and how they develop, and he founded developmental psychology and educational psychology. James M. Cattell, 1860-1944, student in G. Stanley Hall's laboratory course at Johns Hopkins University, and went on to study with Wilhelm Wundt in Germany in 1883. Cattell was interested in studying human abilities and how they could be assessed and measured. Cattell brought this practical approach into the classroom, where he was the first psychologist to teach statistics and advocate their use in data analysis. In 1888, he was appointed a professor of psychology at the University of Pennsylvania. This type of appointment was the first in the world at the time. All other psychologists held positions through a department of philosophy. Cattell's great contribution was his focus on a practical, test-oriented approach to studying mental processes rather than through introspective structuralism. In just the span of 20 years, 1880 to 1900s, the major focal point of psychology shifted from Germany to America. In 1880, anyone wanting a respectable psychology education made a trip to Germany to study with Master Wilhelm Wundt. By 1900s, Americans stayed home to get a superior education in psychology. Behaviorism and Neo-Behaviorism. In 1913, a functionalism-trained John B. Watson literally declared war against the establishment by describing a totally new approach to psychology called behaviorism. The goals of this new behaviorism were to study only behaviors and processes that were totally objective and fully observable. In this new system, there would be no introspection, no discussion of mental concepts, no study of the mind, and no mention of consciousness. Any type of behavior was appropriate for study under Watson as long as it met the criteria of behaviorism. The methods of behaviorism were limited to observation and objective testing experimentation. Neo-behaviorists wanted to study somewhat mentalistic concepts like learning, memory, and problem-solving, but at issue was the inability to directly observe behavior. Neo-behaviorists found a solution by adopting logical positivism. Cognitive psychology. Cognitive psychologists study how mental processes work and how knowledge is formed and used. Topics are wide-ranging, subjects such as attention, memory, problem-solving, reasoning, logic, decision-making, creativity, language, cognitive development, and intelligence are some of the many areas of interest in cognitive psychology. Cognitive psychology is not quite yet a system of psychology, but it is probably the most popular approach in experimental psychology today.